Steve Cadigan, and I'll be moderating today's discussion. And the topic is one on a lot of people's minds. How do you build a culture of innovation? Not just a company where some people make innovative products, but where everyone is engaged and empowered to rethink what they do and to make it better. And we're going to, during the time we're together, talk about a couple of really big companies that have been around a good long time. Because it's one thing to start a company from scratch with innovation in mind, but it's far different when you've been around for 10, 20, or even 100 years, and you have tens of thousands of people who've been doing things in very specific ways for a long time. Over the next 45 minutes, I'll be joined by a number of people, including Melissa Karp, a director of staffing at Google, as well as Bhupesh Arora, who focuses on innovation for Avery Dennison. But we'd also like to hear from you during the program. So if you do have a question, just log in at the bottom of your screen and type it in, and we'll do our best to get to it. But I want to get started with our first guest. She works for a company whose products all of you will recognize. We use their products every day. Whirlpool Corporation is the leading manufacturer and marketer of major home appliances worldwide. And it's my pleasure to bring in Kim Thompson, the Senior Director of Communications from Whirlpool. Kim, welcome to Atmosphere Live.
Thanks for having me.
You know, by any measure, you are a really large company with $19 billion in sales last year, I think, and almost 70,000 employees and more than a century of business success. Clearly, you're not a startup, but sometimes those are the companies we all think of as being agile and nimble and innovative. How do you guys use technology to change culture in a company as big as yours?
That's a good question. I think the first thing to recognize is that cultures don't change, people change. So even when you have full-blown executive support, which we did, success still means that you need to win one person over at a time. In our case, we launched what we call a winning workplace initiative. It focused on three things: the environment, the tools, and the culture. At the end of the day, we rolled out Google Apps to more than 31,000 employees. And today we have story after story of how people are being won over. Our culture is becoming more innovative.
So let's hear those stories, Kim, and walk us through this initiative. You started with environment. What do you mean by that?
You know, our view is that people should be at their best no matter where they work. But we know people work in all sorts of places and ways. We have four regions worldwide. We have remote workers and office workers. And sometimes how you work is really a function of where you work.
Do you really mean that local culture and customs influences whether you work in an office or you work remotely?
Yes, and that's just one aspect of things. This here is a picture of the interior of our North American headquarters in Benton Harbor, Michigan. It's an open plan concept, and that's pretty common, especially in tech companies. But we do know that this won't fly in all parts of the world. In some cultures, a traditional office setting is the acceptable practice no matter what we might think. And so that's why we started with the environment. It's an important lesson for anyone making this transition. Regardless of the tools, you have to help people be at their best no matter where or how they work.
Which brings us to the tools themselves, Google Apps.
Right. I think the best way to understand their impact is maybe through a couple of stories. So let's say I walk into your office and say, Steve, this new tool could really change the way you work. And you'd probably say to me, great, but I have no time to learn anything new. So what we did first was we educated people on the potential of Google Drive and Google Apps. You know, how to store things in one place, collaborate in one document, and then we let our employees discover innovative ways of using the tools. To give you an example, we had a sales team in North America. They were working on their first project together, but they were based in three different cities, in Philadelphia, Phoenix, and Benton Harbor. They had never used Google tools, but collaboration in this case seemed like a good idea, so they took a chance. They simply put up a single slide deck and where everyone could contribute no matter where they were, if they were in an airport or an office, no matter the time of day, because they're in different time zones. And in the end, they would say they cut hours off the project, delivered it on time. And at the end, one of the team members told me, you know, now I'm an advocate of Google Docs and I want more. I want my team to learn more.
That's fantastic. And that's what you mean, I guess, by changing the culture one person at a time. Mm-hmm. Make the tools available, encourage their use, and really see what happens.
Precisely.
You know, that reminds me of a story from my time at LinkedIn when we had something that we called employee group. And this was an internal discussion board on our intranet. And this was a place where people told their stories about what was working and what wasn't. And many times what you'd see is a thread would start with a claim of frustration, only to be followed by someone who had either solved the problem or someone else who had experienced the same problem and was frustrated and wanted to collaborate. And the group acted almost like a self-healing accelerator in a way. And after years of doing employee surveys, we uncovered something really interesting and insightful around this whole concern on productivity. We asked employees in surveys, do you feel you're as productive as you could be? And when we mapped that to turnover data over time, one of the things that was really interesting is that we found that people who felt less productive than they could be left the company at a faster rate than those who really felt productive.
You know what, that's a great segue into my last example. I think this represents a way of working that we've gotten used to, but it's incredibly inefficient. This is what we call a daily shipment estimate. It's simply a form that tells us when a truckload of refrigerators or air conditioners or microwaves will leave a facility. It's pretty simple. But imagine, Steve, you're getting these estimates every day from 8 different regions, and you have to take this information from an email, cut and paste it into a spreadsheet, then reformat it, of course, and then send it back to that, send that spreadsheet to everybody who wants to see it and who needs to use it. A couple of our employees said, there's got to be an easier way. And they were right. So what they did was they built a Google Sheet, they shared it, and now the regions update their own information every day. And if people need a consolidated view, they can go online instead of waiting for an email.
And you know, in my experience in large organizations, this is the one thing that I think is really underappreciated, just how many isolated cases there are out there of people who are feel like they're wasting time with too many activities and a lot of frustration brews.
You know, it's because people have legacy workflows. We'll say things like, let me fax you the information or email you the results, or I'll put that document on the shared drive. We adapt to them. We adopt them, and sometimes it's hard to let those go. It happens at every level in a big company like Whirlpool.
So, Kim, give us a macro view. How did these small successes add up to a big cultural impact?
You know, quite honestly, our biggest challenge today is the number of people who want to change the way they work right now. So in our case, we have a dedicated team of 17 in communications who help employees use Google tools. We get many requests every day, things like, how do I set up Google Drive for my team? How can I get everyone to access Google Sites for information versus calling us all the time? Our employees are moving so quickly now with using these tools and being so innovative that it's really becoming a question of how do we get them the rest of the tools before that they don't quite have yet. And that's an incredible shift for a 103-year-old company.
And that's a high quality problem to have, a large population that wants access to more tools so they can innovate and change faster. Kim, that's a great example for your peers. And thank you so much for joining us today.
All right. Thank you. You're very welcome.
Kim is going to rejoin us a little bit later for a roundtable discussion. And remember, for those of you who just joined or who joined after we already got started, if you do have a question, please log in and type it at the bottom of the screen, and we'll do our best to get to those in a little bit. So let me now turn to our next guest. Like Whirlpool, his innovative organization touches a number of things in your daily life. To get started, let's take a look at this short video to introduce our next guest. It's my pleasure to welcome our next guest on the program, Bhupesh Arora. Senior Director of Global Innovation and Application Services at Avery Dennison. Bhupesh, welcome to Atmosphere Live.
Great to be with you, Steve.
So $6.1 billion in revenue last year and over 25,000 employees worldwide. Recently, I understand from a conversation we had earlier that you guys made a big shift to the cloud. And obviously, this is not something that happens overnight in an organization as large as yours. So can you tell our audience, how did you go about this big change? And what were some of the cultural aspirations as you started to go through it?
That's a great question, Steve. So we viewed our initial decision to move to the cloud with a slightly different lens. And that's not uncommon for a company our size, and that's cost savings. We had a number of systems that were underperforming, both in terms of rate of return and what our employees could really do with them. So essentially, that was throttling our creativity. So a year back, we moved to Google Apps and Google Drive, and the world is much better. Now we have 2.5 million documents on Google Drive. You know what that means, Steve? We have 2.5 million ways of collaborating better.
Oh, that's a great story. I want to go back to something that you said, because I think it resonates with our audience, and that is that cost was the original reason, but it doesn't sound like it was the only one.
No, it was not the only one. We really wanted to change the technology, for sure, but we also wanted to change the way people worked. It is an opportunity for us. We had a culture of innovation as a company, but we want to make it stronger and more nimble. And, you know, to echo what Kim said earlier, we have operations in 50 countries. We cannot dump a technology on people's hand and just walk away. It's much more bigger change that we need to work on.
Is it safe to say that you kept the idea of changing culture in mind as you look to replace those old systems?
You know, it was actually top of mind during the entire process. So what we did is we convened a group of people and we had them walk through certain tools, put them through the paces, and we really listened carefully to what they said. And the feedback was very consistent. Google is easy to use, easy to collaborate, and we don't need training.
Now, training, that brings up a really, really critical issue, I think, for everyone contemplating a big change in their organization. How many classes, how many seminars, how much lost time is a company going to have to endure when they're switching out a huge technology like you just undertook?
You know, Steve, that's a big component of a systems implementation cost, and also after that.
And so did you have a huge budget that you worked on for training?
We don't have it anymore, for sure, part of the system implementation. But now employees are learning through the Google tools by doing it. Learning by doing is going through. People, and that's what we hope, that the tool is so easy to use that people learn themselves, pick it up, and they move on.
And so what tells you that that's really happening? How do you know?
You know, remember that first group of people that we talked about that put the technology through the set of paces out here? So we have a similar group of people, and that's around the world. There are 1,000 people. We call them employee ambassadors. When we want to launch a product, we ask them. We want to research a product, we ask them. And how was the product received? We go and ask them. And we recently did a survey on Google tools with them, and the feedback was overwhelmingly positive. Google is easy to use, makes me more productive. And that's a typical comment we get.
Give us a sense, Bhupesh, if you will, of what people are doing that makes them so productive. What does that look like? Paint us a picture, if you will.
I love that question, Steve. And that's I'm glad you asked that. I'm very passionate about these tools. So there are so many examples. Let's start with the first one, really the one that we are on. It's called Google Hangout, where you launch an online meeting in a couple of clicks. We have teams in more than 50 countries. And prior to piloting Hangout, we were exchanging tons of emails or putting a person on a plane.
Wow. And so what's been the impact for you guys?
So to give you an example, so when we put this Hangout with our quality and production folks, the quality team found an interesting use case where they could look at tests that were being done at various manufacturing facilities and realign those tests, see what's wrong, and virtually get a walkthrough of those facilities. Now, imagine the value of that. You don't need to travel, and also your quality and your production team are virtually connected. And that's huge.
Yeah, that is huge. And Bhupesh, one thing that I'm curious, and I'm sure our listeners are interested in hearing from you as well, is, you know, this sounds great, But how do you, after you launch something and you get all that energy behind a project, how do you keep the momentum going? How do you continue to build that change initiative, if you will?
You know, we've taken a route, and that's an interesting route. So we provide workshops that enable collaboration, and I don't call that training. What we do is we show people what the Google tools can do. Then we step back and watch what they do. And we have dozens of these workshops. And hundreds of ideas. These ideas improve our business processes, both internal and external. This is my good example. We had a workshop with our IT procurement department, and they walked away with the idea of managing the lease requests within the company globally much better. And the simple idea was, why don't we use a collaborative inbox to manage these lease requests? We get emails all over the map, and we don't respond to them efficiently, and we're trying to patch certain things together. So we created this collaborative inbox, which made the whole process centralized, and then procurement department essentially was getting more effective. I'll give you another example, and there's a visual example out here. So every year, Avery Dennison participates in the largest conference in our industry. It's called the Label Expo, and it's focused on labels, product decoration, and web printing. Before Google, we will essentially have a tough time getting everyone together on how we organize, how do we get a booth together for this event. So what we did is we created a collaboration site, which, and this was essentially open to all our employees. What that meant is our employees now could really see what's happening, how we're preparing for this event. And not only that, the project team that was involved in setting up this booth and essentially planning for the event could get all the resources together in one place. And that wasn't possible before. And also keeping our stakeholders on the same page, one place, that was a huge benefit.
Fantastic. Bhupesh, with the benefit of hindsight now, you've been through this significant change. If someone asked you the biggest lessons you've learned from the process, what would you say?
You know, first, you can look at technology shift in two ways. You can make it look tactical, where you're just trying to replace a function, or you can think strategic, where you're shifting the entire organization. If you want to make a big shift, think about where your technology will be in 10 years. Large companies like us don't replace technology on a regular basis, on a daily basis, I mean. Think about who's going to be winning in the marketplace. What are the trends? What will this technology do for your employees? Will that help them collaborate better? Will it make them more productive? And then also make sure if you make a big shift, get the executive buy-in. That's very important. And lastly, my advice is partner with a forward-thinking company, because you're going to get returns faster, and also it'll open the path to innovation.
Wonderful. Bhupesh Arora, thank you so much for being with us today.
Thank you.
I want to bring Kim Thompson from Whirlpool back in the conversation and pause for a second, because we have a bunch of questions flooding in here to address some of what's on the mind of a few people. I've actually got a few here that I'd like to read for both Kim and Bhupesh. When companies undergo a major initiative or a culture shift, there's often resistance. What types of resistance, if any, did each of you face, and how did you overcome those and overcome the inevitable critics that we all face when we do this? Kim, maybe you could start with that question first.
Okay, sure. So thinking about the tools and the changes, I think that the big thing that you run into is it's those workflows that we talked about before. The idea that the way that you get things done, the way that your business is processed, you've been doing it the same way for a long time. And so there will be a few people, and those people are really important. They're your ambassadors that say, you know what, there's got to be a better way to do this. And they become your, they're the ones that help you make the breakthroughs to get past those barriers.
And Bhupesh, did you face some critics or some resistance as you were implementing your big change?
Steve, if you make a big change, you are going to face resistance. That's just nature of the beast, especially a big company like us that's been around for 75 plus years. So we did, and you know, I think, as I said, you start with the angle of cost savings, which we did, right? And you also get executive buy-in, and we talked about that. When you want to make a big shift, make sure the business case is understood. Make sure you get buy-in and ramp it up, you know, so show, prove it out and show it to people that this works. So start small and then go bigger and go big fast. once you prove it out. That's my advice to people.
Great ideas. Thank you both very much. I'd now like to turn to our next guest, who works for a company that you're all familiar with. And it seems to be a company that's just moving at light speed in every direction, from search and cloud to glasses and phones. It's a pleasure to welcome Melissa Karp, Google Director of Staffing, to Atmosphere Live, who's right here with me in the room. Melissa, great to have you.
Terrific to be here.
So Melissa, you've been at Google for about 10 years, and I'm sure you've seen an awful lot of change from starting with just a few people to almost 50,000 today. Did any of the stories of change and innovation that you heard from Kim and Bhupesh ring true for you?
Definitely. Much of what we've heard from both Kim and Bhupesh resonates with our own experience at Google. And I can give you a few examples of that. For example, the food at our company often gets the most press, but there's so much thought that goes into all aspects of the office environment. This is like the point Kim touched on. We put a significant effort into designing spaces that inspire and energize Googlers, as well as reflect our open and collaborative culture.
Interesting. You know, space seems to be a theme that's coming out of the session today. What do you hope happens at Google in these spaces?
Sure. The idea is that employees get to bump into each other, hopefully sparking conversations and new ideas, as well as underscoring our values around creativity, innovation, and playfulness. Mm-hmm. We're also huge users of technology tools to improve and streamline processes with a focus on real-time collaboration, data collection and analysis, and transparency. However, as Kim and Bhupesh both pointed out, the availability of these applications in of themselves don't drive the culture. What really counts is what you do with the information.
Definitely. And I was fully expecting that you have some great stories around using some of the tools that you helped build and contribute to. But give us a sense, you know, how do you do that?
Sure thing. A great example is Google Geist, which is our annual employee satisfaction survey. We just get an amazing number of Googlers taking the survey because we've proven that the organization will really listen and react to their feedback.
Yeah, you know, every organization, and I know this rings true with all the HR leaders that we have dialed in today who've been responsible for administering surveys for a long time, there's always this commitment that, hey, if we're going to ask a question, we're definitely going to follow up and follow through and action it. How does Google address that?
You know, that is always the question. And what we do is we are able to make all of the results available internally. But more than that, we create annual and quarterly goals in our business plans to address the issues raised by the Googlers. And this response is visible at every level of the company, all the way down to individual team action plans. One additional aspect that's really important at Google is using science and data to inform our programs and processes. The idea is to bring the same level of rigor to people decisions that we do to our engineering decisions.
So I would love to understand, I'm sure the audience would too, like, how do you guys go about that? There's a lot of articles written about this, a lot of attention. You guys are quoted often as being very leading in how you think about your employees and creating this really vibrant, innovative culture. But maybe you can share some stories with us of how you actually make the culture one that's more in line with this innovative ideal that Google has.
Yeah, we actually have a dedicated team called People Analytics, and their job is to take a scientific approach to all of our HR offerings. So let me tell you a couple of stories that illustrate that. A long time ago, our co-founder, Sergey Brin, insisted that every Google employee be no more than 200 feet away from food. But in 2012, there was growing concern that, you know, all those goodies being offered may actually kind of be in conflict with the company's goals of promoting a healthy and productive lifestyle. So we decided to run a few experiments to figure out how do we deliver on Sergey's good ideas, but still help Googlers make healthy choices. As part of that, one of the experiments that was run was to see if people would eat smaller portions in the cafeterias. So we started to offer two different plate sizes, one big and one small, along with kind of funny posters that subtly nudged people to make a thoughtful choice.
Well, I know that I would have gone for the bigger plate, but what did you guys find when you guys did that?
You know, we actually, sure enough, saw a 50% increase in the choice of smaller plates, and of course, a corresponding decrease in portion size. It was really amazing. A similar second story evolves around encouraging people to eat healthier options, but in our micro kitchens. So by simply changing the type of candy dispensers and essentially stashing the M&Ms in opaque containers instead of clear ones, we saw a 9% decrease in the proportion of calories people were consuming from Candy.
Oh my gosh, that's amazing that you guys are that thoughtful and investigative into solving that kind of issue. Clearly there's science behind the Google food, I knew it. But what about things like driving productivity, fostering innovation, employee satisfaction? What can you tell us about what Google does in that arena?
Absolutely, we definitely apply the same rigor in those areas. In fact, our co-founder, Larry Page, gave us a great challenge at one point. He said, you know, do managers even matter? So the research team gathered and synthesized more than 10,000 observations about managers from a whole variety of sources, performance reviews, feedback surveys, that kind of thing.
Okay, so we've got a lot of managers on the program today. Drum roll is in the background. What did you learn?
Yes, so it was fascinating. It turns out, thankfully, managers matter a lot. And in fact, the best managers have teams with lower turnover rates, better performance, and greater productivity. They even have just generally happier Googlers, and that was true across all different types of jobs and functions.
Well, I can hear the sigh of relief from all the managers on the line that we actually do matter and we make a difference. Did anything surprise you in the data that you got from that study?
Yeah, there was a big surprise. So being an engineering organization, we thought that having technical skills would be right at the top of the list in terms of what employees wanted in a manager. And it ended up being sort of at the bottom of kind of the top eight. Things that really mattered were managers who were, you know, good coaches, who empowered their teams, who cared about their team members. For us as a staffing team, the great thing about all of this kind of data collection, analysis, and experimentation is that we can literally run it off of Google's collaborative technology tools.
Well, that's awesome. And I got to admit, I'm sure there's a lot of people that feel similarly. I'm so jealous of you being working in this very fertile environment of ideas and tools, and not only using them, but getting to be able to contribute to building them and finding how they can be more effective. But beyond just having access to this technology, in what way has the broader engineering mindset influenced the people agenda, the human resources agenda?
Sure. An answer that you'll hear often to that is this concept of launch and iterate, and people love to say it. And it was originally used to describe the product development cycle, but now it's really been extended to mean across the board, and particularly in human resources, you know, be experimental. You know, don't wait until something's perfect before you launch it and move forward. Think about the users in your design, whoever those users may be, and really be bold and think big.
So, Melissa, how have you applied those in your staffing role?
Sure. You know, an example of that is if you think about our internal job board and our transfer application process. So it just started as this kind of scrappy tool that I actually worked on. And we even tagged it with a beta tag. So people knew that there were kind of bigger things to come. This was just kind of the first iteration. But over time, gosh, that tool has morphed into this sort of more robust and sophisticated program. Then it finally became kind of a standalone application. And now it includes things like training opportunities, performance management tools, and a whole bunch of content related to employee development.
Wow. Melissa, thank you so much. So great examples, great stories. I wish we could go on, but thank you so much.
My pleasure. Thank you.
So that brings us to the end of our session. And first off, I just want to thank all of our guests for sharing their stories. And I guess I'd like to share a final thought. You know, sometimes when we think of innovation, we have this vision or this thought about a breakthrough product or a small startup company that's just ramping. But I think today we've heard from three really impressive organizations that are very large, whose cultures function in very different ways, that all of them are innovating. And the thread that connects everyone in these organizations is that they all encourage and support communication and collaboration. And we've heard every story is honing in on that topic. And to be sure, the technologies let them do and create some great innovation, but fostering communication among your employees is perhaps the most important next step all of us can take in our own organizations to create a culture of innovation. And we're going to end our session now with a video from Google that really captures the spirit of this effort. And remember, for all of you that may have joined late, this session is going to be available for playback on YouTube in case you missed anything or you'd want to hear it again. So in signing off on behalf of all of our guests, thank you so much for joining us. I'm Steve Cadigan. Have an awesome day. Atmosphere Live. We're out.
We want to create technology to dramatically improve the world. To really transform our urban centers.
To preserve and promote culture online.
To study and be inspired by science.
I'm currently combining medical research and computer science to improve breast cancer diagnostics.
That next generation of smart, powerful women, they're already knocking on the door.
Hey, station, this is Google Plus. How do you hear me?
Soichi, hear you loud and clear, honey.
We try to push these challenging technologies to transform the world and change people's lives.
Now we're in uncharted waters, and what I'm talking about has never really been done before. But that's why we should do it.